Okay, so my topic today is energy efficient car routing, and let me shortly introduce myself. My name is Arne Brennschede, and my contribution to OpenStreetMap so far was the B router, which is mostly known as a bike router. So you may ask now, why car routing now? Because bikes are already energy efficient. So the answer is, why not? And in addition, there is this growing demand for energy efficient routing, which is driven by electric mobility and which is not yet addressed by the market players. And B-Router always had a car option, but in the last years it was some sort of experimental mode and was not really a serious option. And this only changed in the last 1 or 2 years when I started adding features that are needed for car routing in order to make that a serious option. So, but start looking at what's the status quo now. This is an example for routing with open source routing machine from Stuttgart to Luxembourg. And this is just the result you expect. It's following the motorway. And you need a 3.5 hour for that. If you shift the destination a little bit further south, then you get a different routing, which is following a primary road for a large fraction. And it's the same time, travel time, it's 3.5 hours, but it's 40 kilometers less. But it's not only 40 kilometers less, but it's the same travel time, so you're traveling more slowly, so the effect on the total fuel consumption is much larger. So there's a really significant effect on the fuel consumption. And the question is, why doesn't that matter here? Why does only the travel time matters? And the answer is, in routing, the only thing that matters is the cost function. And if you put the time as a cost function, then you get the fastest route. And this is what we have seen right now. So if you say energy also have to matter, you have to add energy to the cost function. And this is all about it. This is energy efficient routing. But you see there's this P weight factor, which you have to use to specify your personal preference between energy and time. And of course, by putting a very high number or a very low number for P weight here, you come back to the traditional routing modes for fastest or shortest routing. But the interesting case, of course, is to put a reasonable value for P weight here. And what's a reasonable value? Well, maybe you put 30 kilowatts in, that means you are willing to spend an extra 30 kilowatt hours in energy to save 1 hour travel time. And 30 kilowatt hours is a reasonable number because this translates to about 6 liters fuel, which is €8, which is about the minimum salary in Europe. So this seems to be a reasonable number for the weighting factor. If you have a fuel-driven car, this changes for electric cars where you have situations where you cannot just buy energy, where you also have to spend time to get energy into your battery. So this weighting energy, 30 kilowatt, is the parameter you need to specify your preference, but it's not a user-friendly parameter. Because if I tell you I'm the guy who uses 30 kilowatt when driving as a preference, you don't understand me. But if I say I usually drive 120 kilometers per hour on the motorway, then you know what my preference is. But this is equivalent. You can either specify your nominal speed or you can specify your weighting power. But you can specify only one, and the other one you can calculate from each other. And how you do that? I will show here. So this is the cost function you want to implement. This is time plus energy, and it has two components, the time and the energy. And this is the cost per meter depending on the travel speed, which is shown here. And this is the time component. Of course, it increases with slow speed because you need more time, of course. And this is the energy component, and this increases with high speed, because there is this quadratic increase in air friction. And if you look at the sum of both, you have a minimum somewhere. And right at this minimum, this is the nominal speed you should travel in order to implement this cost function. So this is the mathematical relation between the waiting power and the nominal speed. And if you will get this as a formula, it's like that. It just contains the air friction coefficient and the heating power. So the message is, for energy efficient routing, you need only one parameter, and everything else, the whole kinematics, everything else, you can calculate from that. Even the question, if you are approaching an obstacle and you're asking yourself, what is the point where I use the brake and how much is the rollout phase, you can calculate that all. You just need one parameter to specify your kinematics. And the nice thing here is that you have a minimum in the cost per meter. And this is also what you need in a star routing algorithm to make it efficient. Because a star just has this constraint. And the confusing thing is that if you look for scientific publications on that question, how energy efficient routing for electric cars should work, you find many, many papers that say, oh, that's very complicated, that doesn't work at all, because this energy here will get negative if the car is going downhill, because it's putting energy back into the battery. And this is so complicated, and so you need lots of computer scientists that can finally save the world. But this is just not true, because I didn't say what the energy, this written here, what does it mean? Of course, if that is the energy that you take from the battery, then that's right, and that can get negative. But if you say this is the energy that is finally dissipated by friction, by any sort of friction, air friction, rolling friction, then that cannot be negative by definition. So if I would just have written entropy instead of energy, then that would be clear what that means. And then there's no problem for the routing algorithm at all. So it's really simple to implement energy efficient routing in an A-star router. So now I come to a practical example. This time I don't use OpenStreet Routing Machine, but I use BRouter Web, which is the web version of the BRouter routing engine. And I use the kinematical car routing profile with a nominal speed of 160 kilometers per hour. And as you see here, you get the usual solution following the motorway with a travel time of 50 minutes and an energy consumption of 23 kilowatts per hour. The same for a nominal speed of 120 kilometers gives you a route that follows primary roads for a large fraction, and which is much shorter. And if you even go lower in the nominal speed, you get a route which also takes minor roads in order to make the trip even shorter. So if you now ask for the results are written here for time and energy, and put that in a time energy diagram, you see there's a huge variation in energy consumption, but only a smaller variation in travel time. And this huge variation in energy consumption is almost a factor of four. But the problem is that nobody will believe that, so we'll just skip that for now. And add more nominal speeds to this diagram, and then I see that I still have the three routing options, and I see there is some sort of convex slope defining the efficient border of the solution space. There are, of course, more solutions in this space which are not efficient. For example, if you take the motorway routing but use it at low speeds. I mean, it's not forbidden. You can use a motorway at low speed, but it's not always efficient. And this is what makes the experience of most experienced drivers of what is the cost of speeding. They say, oh, no, it's not a factor of four. It's maybe something like 30%. And this is what's happening here, because they compare something which is not speeding by something which is not efficient. And then they come up with a number, well, this is not so big, maybe not significant. And for a fuel-driven car, this is even lower, because this here is a model for electric cars. and electric cars have a somewhat different physics for the inner friction. But this is not what I am talking about. I'm talking about this. So there's always more than a factor of two in driving range for electric cars, which is subject to planning. And this is so significant that you cannot just ignore that. But the bad thing is there are not yet planning tools available which enable you to use that factor. So to have such a planning tool, obviously you need a router that can do energy efficient routing, but you also need a map that can do that. Because if you doing this low energy solutions, you are hitting minor roads and you need a map where that works, where you don't hit too much problems along the way. Of course, it's easier to follow a motorway because there are not so much errors in the map. So the question is, is OpenStreetMap good for that? So this is part of the low energy solution I showed before, and it's really going through the middle of nowhere. And the good thing is you can really do that. So I tried this with my car and there's no problem at all. You can just use that way. But of course, I know this region and I looked for errors in the road network, and you find many of them. These are small glitches where somebody here, for example, there's a wrong one way and a turnaround, or here there's a wrong small one-way section which locks the street in one direction. So there are many of these small glitches that cut your road network, and it's not really usable anymore for energy efficient routing because you have too much detours just to go around these things. And this is so significant, I just scaled up these two errors here by the area to Germany, and then you can estimate that you have about 1,000 errors of this kind in Germany. And the question is what to do with that, because it's a pity that OpenStreetMap is not usable on that level, the street network, because it's broken. So I started to investigate that, and I wrote a scanner to detect exactly that kind of problem. Just by using the routing engine, and while it's doing its work, it can detect, here there's a place which is a dead end or which is a dead start or here's something wrong, and then report a suspect. So I start developing this suspect manager that enables me to track these issues and look at them. And just a short example, so here are some polygons from Europe which are implemented where you can look into these issues. I choose Germany, then you get the current level secondary. So it's displayed in levels. As long as you have motorway suspects, then only motorway is shown. But here you have only secondary subjects. So you choose one. You have the options to open that in Birouter Web, in OpenStreetMap, in JOSM, or something else. And then, for example, you get this display. Here's the node, which is the suspect node. You can use the router to do some test routings, and immediately you see, okay, there's a problem. Then you can go back to the OpenStreetMap editor. Oops, there's some problem here. To fix these problems. And I would like to show some more details in real life. So this is now not the presentation, this is a browser. I can look at such issues, which is now really an open issue, which is not yet fixed. Oops. So here's the suspect node detected by the scanner. And I don't know yet what's bad here, so I do some test routings. This one is good. This one is good. This one is good. This one is bad. So there's something wrong here. But to know what's wrong, of course you have to dig further into the problem. Apparently very slow. Oops, this looks... This seems to be the old version of the geometry. So I really have to use the standard map, but it's slow at the moment. Okay, I go to ID editor immediately. So now you see what the problem is. Here's a wrong way that prevents you from exiting the roundabout in this way. And what the scanner detected is a dead start here. So this way, there's no way to start from this node in this direction because there is no entrance in this way. And this was the detection. So you sometimes have a detection of some inconsistency in the road network, which is not really the error, but it's an indication of the error. So sometimes if you have a bad quality edit, there are many, many errors. You just detect any inconsistency and see another error. Doesn't matter how it works, but it's really a powerful tool. It's a microscope that directly points you to the dark spots of the road network. So you can fix these issues. So we'll fix that right now. Just turn that around. Okay, that's basically what I wanted to show you. I skip this. And I want to even make some advertisement because this suspect scanner I developed, this is of course usable worldwide, but I used it only in Germany so far. So if you are interested in also connecting your road network in your country, maybe just ask me how it works. I can maybe give more details. I would be happy if I can export this technology to more countries. I mean, we saw a lot of talks on this conference on suspect tracking, on vandalism protection, but this is all basically visual. You saw the issues I showed you, they are really small issues, so you don't really see them, and these are the ones that break your network. And to detect these, you need more powerful tools. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. You can also show the link if someone would like to contribute to the one that you found, or also if you show the link of the pages you show starting. Okay, so if someone has some question.
Hi, nice talk. Nasty question. Let's say I don't believe your model. Have you validated it? Have you tested that it is actually true that taking the shorter route make you save so much energy?
Yeah, I did some validations with a Nissan Leaf electric car and some sort of OWT dongle to record the driving data. And so this is really validated data. But of course, it's the optimum when it's summer, when you need no heating and stuff. So electric driving is more complicated than that.
Okay. Other question?
Yes. I really liked your scanner, and I just want to know more. For example, if the code is open sourced, and if we can find it somewhere, or if you can add other countries.
So you want to use your own instance of the scanner, not just use the data? It's no problem, because this is basically the B-Router routing engine, which is a GPL3 license. And the scanner code is just a branch within GitHub of this project. So you can just build B-Router from the branch and run it.
So this was originally called a bike router, right? So does it do anything with bike routing with like road surface type or elevation? Is there anything worked in like that?
Yeah, this was originally the main feature of a B router that is able to do bike routing considering elevation. And this also in this car model, there is elevation. So it's also a factor for cars. But the nice thing is for electric cars, it's less important than for normal cars, because electric cars have the ability to get the energy back if you go downhill.
OK. We have time for some other question. OK, so thank you very much.